Please join me in welcoming Tara Gandhi Bhattacharjee, Asma Khan, and Ruth Padel.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to all these sessions. My name is Ruth Padel. I'm the Professor of Poetry at King's College London. I had the honour of reading some poems here 2 years ago, and it's wonderful to be back. And this afternoon, I have an even greater honour to present to you the extraordinary person on my left, who Mrs. Tara Bhattacharjee. And she... I'm so sorry, I've got the... Okay, Bhattacharjee. The accent in the wrong place. And she is, as you know, Tara's Gandhi's granddaughter. She's the vice chair of the memorial shrine to him. And she is also very involved in conservation, particularly conservation of the Ganges and the waterways of India. And I have a special, that's very clear, dear to my heart, because I've written a book about tiger conservation in India, also king cobra conservation in India. So I'm very involved in that. Asma seems to have disappeared. She's fled. Okay, well, maybe we could... All right, so Asma Khan is also an extraordinary woman. She has her restaurant. She's made a restaurant in London. She taught herself to cook when she came to Cambridge and was so appalled by British cooking. And her restaurant is only staffed by women. And she cooks all the meals herself. She told me that she regards every guest as sacred. Okay, they have to pay a bill at the end, but they are but they are sacred when they're there, and everybody responds to her. So she's written a wonderful book about it as well. So she's going to be doing the moderating and mainly talking to Tara. But I wanted to start with a little extra, which just happens to be my connection to Gandhi. If we could have the first slide, please. Okay, 1931... Gandhi's movement for Indian independence involved boycotting British goods. And in Lancashire, which is actually where my grandfather's father came from, and he owned a cotton mill, a lot of workers were laid off. And some of the Lancashire cotton families thought, well, if they invited Gandhi to come and see how the workers were poor and unemployed, he might change his mind. So he came up there in September 1931. He came at night because everybody thought police were laid on, they thought there would be demonstrations. And this was my grandfather's aunt, Annie Barlow, who was quite a formidable lady. She never married, as you can see. She looks quite ferocious. But she hosted him in her house. There they are together in his... can we have the next slide, please? It's Greenthorn. It's a place near Bolton in Lancashire called Edgeworth, a little village. And he was an enormous hit with the cotton workers. He told them, I can see you're poor, I can see you're having a hard time, but actually it's much worse in India. And they all... adored him. He said, they took me to their hearts and treated me like one of their own. Can we have the next slide, please? And so you can see, it's all completely genuine on both sides. Is there one more? No, there. Isn't that extraordinary? And so it backfired from the point of view of the managers of the factories. But from the point of view of the workers in Lancashire, they loved him. Have you seen those pictures before?
Some of them I have seen.
Yeah.
I was trying to look for my father because my father had accompanied Gandhi during this time. Oh, yeah. So I was just trying to see that if he was next to Sarojini Naidu or something. No, anyway. It's a very interesting picture.
So, Asma, over to you now.
Following on from looking at these pictures, it must be incredible because you know you have all these photographic archives of your grandfather. But I want to know a more personal thing. What was it like in your family? What are your memories of Gandhi, of being a granddaughter in that household?
Well, memories I have a whole lot. My childhood memories are all connected with till I was 14, with Gandhi, his wife Kasturba, and all the great leaders of the world and India, of course. But today, being a member of Gandhi family for me really means being a member of a very large family all over the world. That is a privilege I feel I've got. Because Gandhi is loved so much by everyone. He's really, people are searching Gandhi everywhere, where Gandhi was, how was he, what did he do, and all that. That I feel I belong to a big family. And I must say that I felt it especially so in Ireland, in Belfast, today in this house of Seamus Heaney. And when you spoke of the cotton, and actually Gandhi's life was like, spiritual journey was like cosmic threads. And in practical work, it was the cotton. And I was asking some person today if Seamus Heaney ever wrote about threads or spinning, because I believe Ireland is also noted, especially Belfast, for the linen cloth.
Yeah.
So I was wondering about that. I would love to see if Seamus Heaney has written something about the threads. So I feel I belong in a practical way. In a journey is on the thread of the spinning wheel, on a cosmic thread. And I feel I'm really part of the family. And today it's a great privilege to be with all of you. And mind you, I don't look it, but I'm feeling very nervous talking to all of you because all of you are members of his family. And one thing I want to make it clear, when you refer to me as a granddaughter of Mahatma Gandhi, I accept it because it's probably true. But I am a granddaughter of his biological granddaughter of his name. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Mahatma is a great soul. The title given to him which he attained, I can't say I belong to that, to which all of you belong. So we are all a large family.
So can I ask you, what did you call him?
He was Gujarati. In that way, actually, I should say Kathiawadi, born in Porbandar, where father is called Bapu, and we call him Bapuji.
So everyone?
Yes, we call him Bapuji. Everyone call him, other senior people call him Bapu. We call him Bapuji. And his wife, I must say, it's never complete talking about Gandhi unless I mention Kasturba. Sanjay Roy knows it very well. So Kasturba means Kastur mother. So now today Gandhi is a father of the nation.
Yes.
But she was so strong. Both were just 14-year-old when they got married. And she fought with him on everything. And then he had to convince her on ground reality. It was so much so, and she really represented that how literacy is different from education.
Absolutely.
She was illiterate, but educated. And she argued with him. In the end, she understood his philosophy even more than him. And I think she became the mother of the nation before Gandhi could become father of the nation.
I wanted to ask about the environment. And whenever I've been with Indian conservationists and we're facing the shrinking of the habitat and the wild animals, everybody brings up something that Gandhi said, that there is enough in the world for everybody's need, but not for everybody's greed. And I wondered what you felt that his vision of the environment was.
You know, I knew my grandfather as a normal grandfather. At that time, I was not conscious that one day I would be talking about him or talking about his philosophy. But they all have a meaning, significance today for me. you know, I think I would call him, if I can, I don't know in English, the original minimalist.
Yeah.
Today we spend so much money on pretending that we don't have anything, the room is empty. to have the spacelessness, we hide so much. But Gandhi was the original minimalist. He did not possess anything. So that is now what comes back. That would be with his concern for the environment. And I believe he's written somewhere, I've not read it myself. Fortunately, I am very lazy. I have got cataract. I don't read very much. I don't write because my fingers pain. So I have lots of excuses like that. But someone told me that what Gandhi said about removing garbage. Garbage is not to be removed from one place to another place. Garbage has to go somewhere where it doesn't remain garbage at all. So that has great meaning. About recycling or about throwing it in the right place or reusing it. And I've heard from senior people, now I'm senior, but they are gone, and now that time next to the Sabarmati River in Gujarat, he said, don't use extra water even this much. Soon India will be without water. He was a genius. He possessed such few things. Maybe, I think, 3 pairs of his clothings. And he was experimenting with truth, which was holistic. The lifestyle, what he ate, what in Hindi is called samagra chintan, the entire thought behind life. And people say that you reach out to people's heart. All of you have reached out to my heart, really. But Gandhi, I thought that he was even touching inanimate objects like this or wood, as though he was touching the soul within. You know that you ask me, I never saw a waste paper basket next to him. What did he do? I never saw him taking a piece of paper, crumpling it up and throwing it. I mean, that is the best I can do for environment, picking something and throwing it in the waste paper basket, which I told Sanjay, look, we Indians have spoiled this. We have thrown some paper on the floor. We should not ruin Belfast. So he took that paper and threw it in the waste paper basket. But Gandhi, I don't remember ever throwing things. He touched everything as though there was life in it. And possessing few things, all that come back to me. And I think he was the most powerful environmentalist one can think of.
And this is probably what you're continuing the legacy with a lot of the work that you're doing.
Let me be very clear, I'm not protecting any legacy, doing nothing like that, really. It is just my experience of my old age that I've collected, and I've realized that to understand Gandhi, is not, of course, one should study him and writings, especially his writings, classic writing. And I believe the definition of classic writing is that you cannot remove one word or add one word. That is perfect writing, like Srimad Hini's poetry.
I wanted to ask about, you mentioned Kasturba, but you know, it's remarkable that, you know, Gandhi got a lot of women in the forefront in the freedom movement. You always see him encouraging women to participate. And, you know, that was significant. And I wanted to know, you know, what your views were, what your memories are, you know, how, you know, his views on women. Did you feel that? Did you realize that?
I realize it now. Gandhi was not a judgmental person. He did not look at someone and say, what you are wearing is wrong. You are like this because you are wearing this. No. But about women, he brought women to the forefront. I don't know whether it will be nice to say, I don't know much history about other countries and cultures, but in India, the fight for women's liberation actually has been done mainly by men. I mean, I'm grateful to men for many reasons, also for this. In India, they have done, actually Gandhi started.
Yeah, Oh, he's been.
And with him also in Bengal, there's the history of great people who have done for women. Gandhi brought these women out and just said, also a very important thing for that time, remember, not today. We wear all kinds, we wear different dresses. I could be wearing, I mean, you international dresses, what you are wearing. We could do anything. But Gandhi specifically at that time told Indian women, if you want to work, if you are ready to go to the prison, if you want to do hard work, you are free, of course, what you wear. But remember, the North Indian dress of salwar kameez, of pajama and kurta, that is very practical. So many Bengali women, Gujarati women, South Indian women took to that dress. Today is very natural. But just remember that among the first people who brought salwar kameez to non-salwar kameez women in India was Gandhi.
So that is significant, I know, because, you know, I have a north, a father from the north, my mother's from the east. And, you know, it's incredible that, you know, he had that kind of vision where it was beyond regionalism, it was practical, you know, what makes sense.
But also what is very interesting is the contradiction in Gandhi. I mean, we take it as contradiction natural, that he never told anyone do this, because I don't think Kasturba ever changed her way of attire. My mother did not. So it was not he was forcing it, but women, he said, if you want to go ahead, if you want to march on the road, if you want to do this, this is more practical. Also, now, there were great women who were inspired by Gandhi, and one of them we saw in your picture, Sarojini Naidu. So he, of course he did, he brought women in the forefront.
I now want to ask you a question. I have to explain, because, you know, Gandhi is a significant figure in our history, our Indian history, but, you know, you are blessed to have another grandparent who was incredible. You know, Dr. C. Gopalachari was a significant person. He was the first Indian Governor General, played a huge role, a great intellect, and wow, to have two grandparents of that caliber is such a blessing. But I'm curious to know one thing, that when you had people like this in your family, the rest of your family, the next generations, didn't get into politics, which would be logical considering you had two heavyweights in your family. I want to know, is it because you felt it was not important to be in politics, you could make a difference from outside? I just want to know your views, because, you know, none of you actually went on to follow the footsteps of either of your grandparents.
No, we certainly have not gone in the footsteps of grandfathers, that's for sure. We are not like them. We are different. But about politics, yes, probably we are not in power. I think Gandhi encouraged more of social work, service to society. Yeah. And that's what he kept for his children, for his boys. Gandhi and his wife had four sons. No daughter. My father was the youngest son. So Gandhi actually never told his children to join politics.
Okay,
or to work for power, in power position. He didn't tell his children. He did not say, my grandchildren should not also do it, or my great-grandchildren should not do it. He never said any such thing. But they were all devoted to service to society. Okay. And that was important. And having another maternal grandfather, actually, I think of Gandhi as a grandfather in a normal way. Now I'm trying to see so much significance in what he said, what he did. If you ask me who was greater among the two, I will not be able to say.
I think both that's a tough
both
question.
It will be tough, not because they're my grandfathers. They had the same values. If he had three pairs of clothing, the other one also had three. One fasted. The other never fasted, but ate very little, which probably is more difficult than fasting.
Yes.
Both went to jails. One lived with the entire community like a family. The other lived just with a close family. But he was so, maternal grandfather was spiritually so strong, younger than Gandhi. And my maternal grandfather referred to Bapuji as my master. And Bapuji said, you are the custodian of my conscience.
Oh, that's a wonderful story. I didn't know. But it's interesting because, you know, their children fell in love. I I read this, I don't know whether it's true, about this kind of the two young people falling in love and then eventually
yes.
got married.
Well, I'll just talk about my parents. Yes, they fell. Don't ask me how I fell in love with my
parents. No, I wouldn't dare. I'm asking about your parents.
But I'll tell you, my mother and father, as they call, it was a love marriage. I used to tell my mother, was yours a love marriage? She said, love marriage? You think marriage which are arranged don't have love? So it was my father fell in love with this young girl in South India. He was sent to South India by my grandfather. Now that is another story about Gandhi. He's returned from South Africa in 1902 or 03 or 04, I'm not so sure. And he sent his younger two sons to Shantiniketan, then to Bihar. After that, he sent my father to different places like Tamil Nadu to teach Hindi. He said, on the condition that when you teach Hindi, you are learning Tamil. In that connection, he met my maternal grandfather, who was also a freedom fighter, non-violent freedom fighter. And he met my mother, and it was a big, of course, I mean, again, there were divisions like caste system. My mother came from a very high caste. And my father came from, caste-wise, Gandhi comes from the third caste. And Gandhi actually means merchants of spices and perfumes. It's a surname. Not very, very common, but not uncommon in Gujarat and Punjab. So Gandhi was the name, and he was actually in the system, it was the third caste. And here, of course, we don't want to talk of castes. We don't want to think of it because here we are to break all the divisions. So finally, they got married. And that was a very good story.
So how did she find moving from South India to a Gujarati household? What did she think of the food?
She found it. Look, food, I tell you, she found it very difficult. Food still remains the subject of fight between all husbands and wives in India. Because every household has a way of cooking, and the first fight is on the food, what spices you have used. We do this, my mother did this, my aunt this, your mother has done this, this is wrong.
This is normal, yes.
No, this is normal. In India, it's very, very normal.
But the South Indian
too. But my mother said it very nicely. She said, I went and married this Gujarati, stayed in an ashram. At night, their food was very early. At 6, they brought thick roti, bajra roti, and cold milk. She said, is it this any food? I am not going to eat it. I mean, where have I got married, where they eat this thick roti and milk? Then Kasturba. Now coming to Kasturba. She said, all rules of the ashram have to be broken. My daughter-in-law cannot eat this. Rice has to be cooked for her. So rice was brought in the family. And in our household, the food was mixed Gujarati and Tamil. But now all over India, of course, food, the authentic food of Gandhi, so-called Gandhi ashrams, are better not. That's a different subject altogether.
I'm not asking a question
on that. Because they're all going down. I don't want to say anything bad about India. I don't know what they'll do to me when I go back. But the food in the so-called Gandhian institution still remains supreme for me. It's very good. Almost competes with the lunch we've had here.
Thank you so much. I'm not sure how much time we have left.
We've got another quarter of an hour before opening it up.
Okay,
perhaps we might ask about Gandhi. What Gandhi's vision for the future.
Yes.
What you felt, there's so much I want to ask.
Please do. Gandhi's vision for future.
Yeah.
You know, now when I think back, Gandhi before partition, before India became politically liberated, Gandhi came out of the jail. His wife had died in the jail, his strongest supporter. But Gandhi had the strength because the leaders were all fallen, you know, mentally they were very low. And I remember very clearly all leaders coming to Gandhi, Nehru coming and all of them coming and telling Gandhi, what shall we do? I remember clearly Nehru running, Sardar Patel coming and Qaede Azam Jinnah coming. Gandhi had all the strength, but after freedom, political freedom, I emphasize, Gandhi was a despondent man. He was a sad man at the end of his life. Not because only because of the partition, because he saw the weaknesses, the enemy within is worse than the enemy without. And to fight our own enemy will be a difficult task, and he saw the greed for power. Greed for power, you know, where to get what. And I think I could see that. But my mother put it very differently. He said, you know, Gandhi is now an orphan. Of course, I was 14 and she could share with me. I was the only daughter of the younger son. And my mother said, after Kasturba has died, Gandhi's clothes are not that clean as they were. Gandhi, no one is paying attention to his food as much as they should. Gandhi is not having enough rest as he should. But I now look back, he was a despondent person because he saw the enemy within and our own social injustice. And he thought of, unto the last, the book written by John Ruskin and called it, it was earlier Jay Prakash Narayan who started it, the Sarvodaya Andolan. And the Sarvodaya Andolan is reawakening of the spirit in harmony with all life. That non-violent revolution he was living for, he could not complete it, he could not even start it. That is the challenge ahead of us today. But while I speak about Gandhi in this way, I would like everyone to remember that it was great fun to be with Gandhi. His sense of laughter, his humor, his sense of adventure. What word have you learned today of a new language? Why are you wearing all these ornaments? You think you look more beautiful like that? You should. Why? You can be natural. I never listened to him. He never said it twice, only once. You know, you must improve your handwriting, he said. And write again. You write very badly. Okay. But he had a sense of humor. But he was despondent. But before I go into the despondent, I would like to say a story, and I think Sanjay has heard it 100 times, but I'm not going to leave this audience without a story. It was before the audience, before the independence, all the leaders were coming. Sir Stafford Cripps had come on the Cripps mission, and there was a huge crowd, and he came to Gandhi, and he said, Gandhi stopped the crowd. He was going ahead for the prayer meeting, and Sir Stafford Cripps came ahead, shook hands. How do you do? And here's this adolescent girl standing next to him, me. This is my granddaughter, daughter of my youngest son. I shook hands with a white man. I was so happy, I can't tell you. And this was the chance to speak English. How do you do? I said, oh, I had fever yesterday, the doctor came. He gave me an aspirin. I think I could not go to school. Maybe I'll go to school tomorrow. I don't. Gandhi was shocked. He took me aside. He couldn't care for Sir Stafford Cripps, or he could not think of the prayer meeting. Took me aside. He said, Tara, in English, when they say, how do you do? The answer is only, how do you do? They are not interested in your health. I was sad for various reasons. I had made a fool of myself before a white man, A. I could not speak English, B. And my grandfather shocked me beyond limit. He spoke of nothing but health to everyone. Every letter of his, the first para was, did you have your lime juice? Did you fast yesterday? This particular vegetable is good for you. Eat more of this, less of this. Take some massage. Take some natural therapy. So first para of every letter, whether it was Mountbatten or Lajpat Rai or Churchill, was on health. I don't know what he wrote to Churchill about cigarette or smoking. I don't know. But everything was about health, and here he's telling his granddaughter, they are not interested in health. Oh my God. So anyway, that is something to remember about Gandhi.
This might seem a rather silly question, but ignorant question. Did you live with him or did you visit him?
No. You know, my father was a youngest son. So happened that the last stage of Gandhi, the last 14 years of Gandhi's life, and my first 14 years were almost together. So we visited him our vacations, school vacations, or we took leave from school. That's why we failed. I failed because I didn't do well. But anyway, the excuse was I could not go to school because I had to visit all the relatives with my parents in the prisons. But we used to visit Gandhi in the prisons or in the railway stations or in the ashrams. So our childhood was spent like that, visiting Gandhi and all that. And one thing to remember Gandhi, which I tell my children, I tell my granddaughters, I tell my grandson, Vidur, who is very fond of environment. And I said, you know, I am talking about my life to all of you. I tell my granddaughters and grandson Vidur that, but my grandfather, he never spoke of the past. I never heard from him what he did in South Africa, what he did in the jail. He was a man of the moment, of this moment, now and here, nothing before.
That's really interesting.
You know, that is something that stays with me now. Why? I mean, grandparents always talk of grandchildren, stories to the grandchildren. He never ever talked. I think it was because he was moving ahead. He was moving ahead, you know.
And also, I guess that is such a magical time. You know, change was happening. You could see freedom.
He was a formidable genius. He was such a great psychologist that an enemy would enter Mr. Gandhi. I do not believe. I remember people entering the room like that. His doors were always open. There were no security guards. There was no police. Mr. Gandhi, I don't. And immediately he would leave as a friend, not always convinced with what Gandhi said, but leaving as a friend. So this was a magic in him. I think he was a psychologist. I really don't know. He was one man corporate leader, one man agriculture, one man economy, one man finance, one man railways. Please don't take it to India. They'll think I'm bringing some change in the government or what. I have no idea for that. But anyway, this Gandhi was really one man for everything. He had said the last word. In fact, our late leader belonging to the present party, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, who was an adorable politician and person, he once said in a meeting, we cannot say anything on any area of life because Gandhi has said the last word on it. So you're asking me about a genius. I can only be limited.
But we are very, very grateful for getting this incredible insight into someone that, you know, and as an Indian, you know, you start your realization of being Indian by knowing about Gandhi. Yes. So actually, I'm very in awe, and you know, I feel very privileged to be talking to you, because you know, it means, you know, that is the one figure that unites all of India. Gandhi is that one figure, and you know, meaning so much for everyone.
There is one figure that unites everyone. She's already started with the cotton threads. I'll take this message to India, to the cotton people. They still are having problems.
Yes, I've heard, but it's now also, I mean, cotton farmers are very despondent now.
Yes.
So I wonder, we might throw it open. Yeah. There must be many people here who would love to ask questions. I don't know, is there a roving mic?
Or maybe you can have this one.
Oh, you have it there. Okay. Everything's laid on here. So, who would like any questions?
Thank you. Hello, Tara. You're very, very welcome to Ireland. I'm just wondering, did Gandhi have any Irish connections? Was he influenced by any people of his time from Ireland? There's mention of a Margaret Cousins, supposedly the writer of the Indian National Anthem, the music. James Cousins, George Russell. I'm just wondering, are you aware of any of that? Thank you.
He was very good with English language, and Bernard Shaw was a great fan of Gandhi. Bernard Shaw was also a good, very good friend of my father. So that connection we have with Ireland. Gandhi, what you said, especially about Ireland, I'll have to read. As I said, this opportunity to come to Ireland has made me feel that I should learn about Ireland. And I also try to find out what Gandhi had to say about Ireland. I'm sure he did, because there's such a bond between us. I don't see the divisions here. I see I see what brings us together, Indians and the Irish people. I'm sure Gandhi had it. I'll have to look at his work and read on it. I must admit I'm not very well informed on that, but I must say that I, as a college student, was absolutely the adolescent love for Yeats and Oscar Wilde and Bernard Shaw, who became a very close friend of our family.
Thanks. Thank you. Yes, question here.
Thank you. My name is Christine. Some years ago at a conference of peace and reconciliation in Switzerland, organized by an international organization called Initiatives of Change, I met another Gandhi, Mohandal Das, also a grandson of Gandhi.
Rajmohan Gandhi?
Yes.
Is it not Rajmohan Gandhi, you said?
I think that was the name.
Yes, you know, Gandhi had four sons. Now, the four sons have grandchildren. Grandchildren have others also. Now, and the eldest son was older. So I won't be surprised if there are so many Gandhis all around, actual with blood connection. But my brother, Rajmohan Gandhi, if you have said yes, his name is Mohan.
Yes.
And the second brother, I'm talking my father's children. Second is no more. He was a very great philosopher on his own. And the third, Gopal Krishna Gandhi, he is very much in politics, not the sort of the fighting politics, but the genuine politics. And I suppose, because you have said Mohan, suppose it's Rajmohan Gandhi, who is a writer who has written many biographies.
Yes, yeah, and very involved in peace process and bringing leaders and people from around the world to Switzerland to sit and talk together and forward peace.
I think so, but you know, I would like to actually, the peace process, that is some one word I have never understood, peace process. I mean, one thing I have not understood, but I suppose to find peace within is probably the first step to peace process. And also to listen to others and all that. All of you have given me a message of peace, by the way. I must say that. Thank you for the message.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, question. And after that.
Good afternoon, Tara. I worked with your brother, Rajmohan, for several years in India.
I see.
I lived in Madras, as it was then, mm-hmm. and Chennai. And he took me to meet Rajaji once in the early 1970s. And as soon as he heard I was from Ireland, Rajaji said, gosh, how grateful we are for the help that the Irish independence leaders gave us during their time in negotiating with Britain and later leading up to the independence of India.
That answers your question.
And the your grandfather, I asked him if he would write an article about Ireland in Swarajya, mm-hmm. The party newspaper, and he did. In fact, he wrote two articles in subsequent weeks. The first article I was not expecting, but he castigated the British for allowing the mayor of Cork, Terence McSweeney, to die on hunger strike in 1919. And he went on to talk about how important that sacrifice had meant for the Indian independence leaders, mm-hmm. including the Mahatma. Mm-hmm. And then in the subsequent article, he talked about the talks that they had before the independence. And one of the people who were involved in those talks was Professor Nicholas Mansour, the father of Dr. Martin Mansour, who actually had a key role in our peace process,
yes.
and that came to the Good Friday Agreement. But I'm glad to meet you, and I met your mother and your other
Thank
brother,
you
Gopal.
But you didn't meet her.
Thank you so much.
excuse me.
Thank you.
Oh, hello. I'm married to this gentleman. But I came today with my husband, who knows a lot about India and Ireland, but I've come specially today to hear something about your other grandfather. I don't know if that was the brief for your speaking today, but could you tell us a little bit something about... Alec told me that he was regarded as a seer, and what was his other role?
Yes. Raj Gopalachari is known, he was known as Rajaji. Yeah. Yes. Rajaji. And you want to know more about him?
Yes, yes, because he was an equally influential person, but less well known to Westerners.
Yes, yes. He had traveled, I think, only once out of country. Gandhi had come to London several times and then he went to South Africa. Rajaji had not traveled very much. But I believe I used to hear from there was a very important member of the Nehru family whose wife was Hungarian. Fori auntie, we called her. And she used to tell me stories about Rajaji visiting New York to meet Mr. Kennedy. And I believe Rajaji, when he went to America, first set his foot on a foreign soil. And he asked Mrs. Nehru, he said, "Do you think I can get hot water for bathing for my morning?" You know, she said, "Of course, Rajaji, you can get." Then he said, "You think I can have idlis for my morning breakfast?" She said, "Of course, you can have." Then I believe when he went to see President Kennedy, he said, "Am I standing next to the president of? Am I facing the president of America?" And Kennedy said, "Yes, you are facing the president of America." I mean, that is one thing about... He was known for his wit and for the clarity of his mind, who was never afraid to disagree. One man who was the custodian of the conscience of Gandhi, but was a master, was a guru to Jawaharlal Nehru. I remember when... We were living in Delhi at that time. Whenever Rajaji came, he stayed with us. Although, mind you, he was the first Governor General after Lord Mountbatten went. The first person to take over before India had a president was Rajgopalacharya, who was the Governor of Bombay, made the Governor of Bombay. Of course, he had power, political power. Then he came to Delhi. And after that, when he had given up political positions, whenever he visited Delhi, Pandit Nehru, he started his day by visiting Rajaji and discussed the entire day's situation and got Rajaji's advice. And I remember that was after independence. I was a college girl and going and all that. I remember my aunt who used to look after my grandfather, you know, shouting at the cook and all that, "Please, Nehru has come, bring the idlis, bring the coffee, fast, you know, because Nehru doesn't have enough time." And Rajaji would sit quietly and give all the advice, everything to Nehru. So I remember, apart from his relationship with Gandhi, which was unique, his relationship with Nehru was also very unique. And Rajaji never was afraid to criticize the opposite person. One thing I would say that if I have to compare, I'm saying it, I don't like the word tolerance, but here I'll have to use it, because why should we tolerate injustice? It's a wrong word. It should be respect for each other, not tolerance. Anyway, but Rajaji was less tolerant than Gandhi with things that would go wrong around him. Probably. But he was known for his private privacy, for his simplicity, for his brilliant mind. And by the way, just to a family story, when Vinayak, my son, he was here, he was born, on Ganesh Chaturthi, the day of Lord Ganesha, the elephant. and Rajaji was in Delhi when Vinayak was born. Rajaji heard that Vinayak is born, it was Ganesh Chaturthi. So he came and he said, my blessings to Vinayak. So that's how he was named, Vinayak.
Just before we have the next question, I just want to clear up, there may be some people here who haven't eaten idlis. And it's a very...
Yes.
Right. And my sister-in-law is Indian. She comes from Orissa. And when my brother first took her to his cottage in Wales, she looked at these very nice green mountains and she looked in dismay and she said, but where will we get our idlis? And perhaps Asma could explain exactly what an idli is.
I think you need to eat it to understand it. If I described it as steamed rice, like their dumplings, they're like rice cakes. Muffins, but like it doesn't do it justice, because it actually is something beautiful and has to be enjoyed. You've got to try it. I think we actually have run out of time.
Well, no, we've got time.
Okay, we can do one more question.
So there's a question up there.
No, I'm keeping an eye. Thank you very much indeed for coming. It's a privilege to meet you, Tara. May I just ask you a question, taking you back to when you were a young child, going in to visit your grandfather in prison. How did that affect you as a person? And what did your grandfather say to you while he was in the prison cell?
How did it feel going to visit him as a child, especially in prison?
That's a good question. How did it feel to visit him in the prison? You know, there was never a moment of sadness. I mean, I don't remember we are going through any depression or sadness. I mean, police would knock on the door in the morning and take my father away to the jail, and we would hear my grandfather is also in the prison, and maternal grandfather, and my paternal grandmother, of course, and all that. So for us, it was holidays spent on visiting Gandhi, and whether it was prison or not. I remember his last prison, Aga Khan Palace in Pune, where we had gone. We used to go there quite often because it was a long stay and where my grandmother died. I went there once, and that time travel was difficult. You had to book the train compartment, find a place, and do your own cooking, and then find a tonga, you know, a horse carriage or something to get to the prison, to the palace, and get the permission of the warden. But anyway, we managed all that. I was a young girl, and I went there, and my grandmother was lying down. She was very frail, not well at all. Gandhi would smile. I mean, I never felt any depression. I felt joy, you know, that I'm going to meet them. Prison or no prison didn't matter. But my grandmother called me, and my grandfather would, you know, he would have a nice smile. And my grandmother just called me near her. She was in bed. She said, come here. She asked one of her, disciples, women. She said, Devdas's Tara, my father's name was Devdas's Tara, has come. Please give her that sari I have kept for her. Because saris in this family to the daughter should go from the grandmother. First sari. So that girl went and brought a beautiful khadi handmade sari for me. I took it and was running out of the prison. So my grandmother said, no, why? I said, because my grandfather will say, don't give it to her, give it to a needy person, she doesn't need it. I said, I really could not believe I was having a sari, that Gandhi would not snatch it away from me. I ran. He looked at me and he shook his head. And I understood the meaning of needy person. I was in need of my grandmother's affection. She was in need of giving it. So there are needs of every level. There I learned a message from my grandmother. I was so happy. My grandfather was telling my father how he plays badminton and how he plays the carom board and all that. There was a butte, 4 times bigger than this room, or I don't know, I thought it was big. I told my grandmother, shall I go and play there? There are no guards, you know, Ba, it means mother, there are no guards here. Can I go and play there? So my grandmother said, guards or no guards, you are not allowed to do something. Why should there be a guard? Don't do it. That is the true meaning of independent swaraj, means self-control. democracies are not run by governments, they are run by people. And a citizen is answerable, not the government. This is a message I learned from my grandmother.
Well, I think we have time for one more question.
Thank you for coming to Belfast. What I wanted to ask you was, Gandhi's assassination, what are your thoughts on that and the political repercussions that followed after that?
Now, that is, I'll answer it in my own way. As you've seen, it's nothing academic here. But it is very human. I used to go to the evening prayers. That time it was after independence. I was late in coming back from school. So I was late and I wanted to finish the homework first and then go to the prayer. But it was getting late. I saw my parents were not there. But the telephones were ringing. My father was an editor of a very patriotic journal. And I was used to these telephone calls. So I picked up one. Do you know that Bapuji has been shot at? I put the phone down. Again, Gandhi has been shot. Put the phone down. Third phone, somebody coming in. Please, Gandhi has been assassinated. So my youngest brother, Gopal Krishna Gandhi, was there. I took him and ran out of the house. And I went there. There was a huge crowd outside the building, a huge crowd. I mean, I must say that I didn't know how to enter. We used to go and see Gandhi, but we were guests there. So Gandhi said, guests should come from the side road. Don't take the main road, main door. But I knocked on the main door. If you ever visit Delhi, see that memorial. And I knocked on that door and I said, open it, I am his granddaughter for me, please let me come in. I went there and I saw my father, Jawaharlal Nehru, my mother, and two cousins who were looking after Gandhi. That's about all. His blood-stained cloth was there, he was lying down, they were all weeping. My father said, I first saw his voice cracking. He said, please touch his feet, Tara, Bapuji is gone. Again, you know, I was speechless. I thought he would wake up. And then there were crowds and Gandhi was taken up. Next day, of course, there was a cremation and a huge crowd and letters pouring in from all over the world. And I remember my father had to give that last speech also. And there was some contradiction, although you people have not asked, contradiction in the thought process of my Gandhi's eldest son and Gandhi, because he never listened to his father. He came running. He was much older than my father. And I was in the house. My father had gone to the cremation. And my uncle said, I said to my uncle, you should have gone to the cremation. Why are you here? He said, I do not deserve to do the cremation of that great man. Your father has the right. I don't have the right. He said, since we have the time, it is a very cold day, but the sun is shining. Let me teach you how to wash, how to do laundry properly. Let's wash the clothes. That was true Gandhian, from a man who was not supposed to be Gandhian. So my story ends there on Gandhi.
Well, that's an extraordinary place to stop. And I am sure you'll all agree it's been a complete sort of still privilege to hear you, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.